Look 33. He looks a lot younger. Sorry.
33?
Huh? Yeah, no, that's me. I'm 33. Oh,
you're definitely you see, shame that. I'm fucking not 33.
It was about time, wasn't it? It was getting silly.
Yeah, he's looking a bit mad, isn't it?
Oh.
I reckon you're both at the end of very long days, so I can't. I thank you already for coming on. But how are we doing, boys? Okay.
All good. Yeah.
Listen, I want to get the ball rolling straight away because myself and Nisse were speaking just a moment ago. Boxing is back for the time being with fans on their card, which is amazing for the sport. And I tell you what, fight camp's been good. The stuff with Frank Warren in BT Studios, New York Hall is good. But fans are coming back, and that's the big news.
Hey, wait a minute. I haven't heard that. Are you talking about the Denmark show that Sauerland's doing, or are you talking about in the UK?
No, the Denmark show that the Sauerland boys putting on.
This is some mad news. I ain't heard this one. That's
Germany as well. Germany as well. There's fans back in the football. I've heard the football here is going to have fans back as well.
Yeah, they've done a few.
10 clubs, isn't it, this weekend? 10 clubs.
Yeah. The EFL,
trialing 1,000 fans. But as a sports fan, not just boxing, not just football, all sport have been crying out for them to come back. I mean, it's weird. It looks like training matches with the football games without the crowds in. So you must be pretty happy that the fans are in there. That's the dream, isn't it?
I mean, I've got to say, I'm used to that everyone slagged off those sound effects of the football. I'm kind of used to it now. I quite like them. I tried it without the sound effects, and then it's proper Sunday League. You hear everyone swearing, which is quite good as well. I'm very excited to have the fans back. Very excited. I just want it to happen over here as well in the UK. I mean, people are talking about these 30-second tests, these Chinese vaccines, these vaccines from here, from there, which is... You know, we just need to start letting people back in, you know?
Is it
not before? No, it's a denied vaccine.
Yeah. Oh, man.
No, it's quite... How hard is it to try and put events on when, you can't sell tickets?
We haven't... we've had a show. Obviously, I think in the UK it's a lot more difficult because, you know, you're selling out the O2 and that's a considerable amount of money. But then also the ticket sellers, you know, the natural ecosystem of boxing, the guys who want to get the experience in the ring, who can sell some tickets, the Goodwin shows, the Steve Wood shows, all these guys who are so, may get overlooked or whatever else, but they're so important for the game and so important for the development of boxing and boxing. Not everyone starts off in front of, at the O2 in front of 10,000 people or 15,000 people. Mm-hmm. People start on these shows, and you've got them, you know, from Thursday to Saturday. I think you've got 6-7 shows a night that you don't even hear of. Yeah, so I mean, these aren't happening at the moment. Fine, we're getting the big shows on the TV, but I just feel for the smaller shows because we need that. We need the feeders. It's like West Ham and Tottenham. It's the feeder side to Tottenham is. Bad joke, sorry, West Ham friend. But you know, you need these guys getting experience out there, because quite simply, the depth of talent in the UK is, I've said this so many times, is just mental. You know, how many good fighters don't get signed over here? I remember we signed a kid called Zach Parker, and he's a phenomenal talent. But we had no competition to sign him because everyone's like they're looking in the wrong places, or I don't know where they're looking, but there's so many good fighters right in front of people's faces and they don't see them. For instance, let's say Dillian's new trainer, Xavier, he's got a load of like good talent, doesn't he? I mean, they're not signed and they're good fighters. There's kids everywhere. So yeah, that is the issue we have with the tickets. That is the big issue, I think, in the UK. In Germany, not so much, because the revenue, if I'm honest, Germans, for some weird reason, do not buy as many tickets or do not like going out as much as the Brits. So it's definitely, you know, if you got income from TV is number one. Number two is normally ticket sort of sponsorship like that. In Germany, its sponsorship is normally higher than your ticket. So it doesn't make that much of a difference. But here, it does. You know, for the high level, so let's say the Wembley Stadium, the O2s, the whatevers, but also at the lower level, that is what's going to really suffer at the moment.
So do you think the sport as a whole has suffered then and will continue to suffer because we've just had a, maybe not a year, but 6 months at least of development on hold?
I think at the moment as a freezing. I think everything's frozen and everything is starting to unfreeze now. And I hope that will be, that will also be the like I said, the small hall shows. And then, of course, the big shows. But yeah, I mean, you know, I think people are having to take pay cuts at the top. But then you've got to also think about the guys who make money week in, week out as a journeyman, the young pro who, well, you know what? I've got a traineeship as a plumber. I'm not getting my fights anymore. It's a good, great job to be a plumber. You make, you know, one of my best friends a plumber. You make a great living out of it. It's regular. I'm not going to be a boxer anymore, you know, and for me, that's sad to see.
Dean, you work with a lot of young fighters. Are you seeing the same thing?
Yeah, do you know what it is? That everyone wants to be out there. The boys want to fight. And look, the thing is, with my boys, that I've been training them throughout the whole of the pandemic. So while obviously the pandemic's been going on, when we was getting our exercise time, we was in the park, we was training, we was out there, we was working, you know, and I think they started to get annoyed or fed up with the training aspect because it's like endless training with no end result. But I'm saying to them, well, listen, at the end of the day, this is a good opportunity to hone your craft and continue trying to build that mental toughness because you're going to have to be mentally tough with this challenging time. And it's not just us. This is a world globally issue where the pandemic's been. So, you know, if you can get through this, just like many people, because look, we've seen a spike in mental health issues and other stuff around the globe, especially in the UK, because we've got a big problem with that anyway. But there's a spike in that drinking, gambling, loads of things. So if you can keep your mind right as a boxer, as a professional, stay in the gym, stay disciplined, keep your mind on the task. When you go in there, you know, it's like not a cinch, but it's like, listen, the worst of it's behind me. I'm on the show now. And now, like he says, the next thing is a lot of the small shows are the ones that are suffering. The Mo Pryors, the Goodwins, the MTKs have come back. They've got great funding. They're putting on spectacular shows. The smaller ones behind them are the ones that's been suffering for a while. So it's been a difficult time for the lower level people, unless you're on the likes of Frank Warren, Matchroom or MTK. Now they've just come back. You're going to be suffering. You're possibly going to be out until next year. I spoke to Mo. I know he's been considering doing a show. I've heard he might potentially do one at the end of October. I don't know if the figures are right for him or what, but I mean,
phone ring off the hook.
Yeah. So it's get me a fight. Right, listen, everyone's under pressure trying to get to their managers, their promoters and say, listen, I need to go. Best thing you can do is keep yourself in the gym, have a tear up with your neighbor, your dog. Anyone you want, just keep in shape. Bob Reed, and just touch and roll. You know what I mean? Keep yourself active. Keep yourself sharp. But, you know, don't hurt anyone. Do the ring time kicks in. You get me, bud?
Yeah.
It's too funny. But, yeah, it's a difficult time. But let's see how the next couple of months go.
When fans start coming back in, money starts coming back in, people sit up and take notice. That's what makes it go around, isn't it? If people are paying to come into it, sponsors start getting back involved because their brand is being seen, TV shows. We're seeing a lot more on Channel 5 now. Channel 5 is picking up boxing again at a decent rate. I think that might just get the wheels turning again.
Absolutely. The thing, it's a bit different because, look, they've had the budget all the time anyway, Channel 5, you know, because Mick Hennessy's been there a very long time. And now what's happening, he's signed a few talented guys. He signed Shaqan Peters down there. He signed Idris Elba. Is it not wrong guy, Idris Elba? Sorry, Idris Burkle. All right, sorry about that.
That's a compliment, man.
That's a world exclusive. Dean Whyte has just let slip Idris Elba's fighting on
Channel 5. My bad, I don't even know what's going on. Sorry, it's all mad. I've literally had a long day. Excuse me. I've been bloody doing interviews earlier as well. It's all long. It's been a long day. I'm tired. But I mean, Idris Burkle. Say it again.
Don't call me Calla.
No, I'm going to call you Carl Froch. Carl Froch is with, I mean, sorry. you know, just any names.
Do you know one reason I was looking forward to having this on tonight? Is because speaking of your camp and your fighters and stuff, we had Tom Little on here the other week, and he was speaking about Filip Hrgovic, and he was just saying, the guy is a demon. Because Dean will remember this. We were speaking about Daniel Dubois and Joe Joyce, that fight that keeps getting kicked back, but it is going to happen at some point. And we were talking about Dubois, how strong he is, blah, blah, blah. And then he said, but he's not the hardest puncher I've ever faced. Filip Hrgovic is. He started doing some reading up on Hrgovic, and he's being linked to all these different names, from Dubois, Joyce, all the way up to could be fighting Joshua. Babich is calling him out. This guy's going to have something to say on the scene, isn't he?
Wrecking ball.
I mean, we're going to, you know, we're putting him on in Denmark next week, just purely for the fact to keep him busy. You know, and then we'll be on a DAZN show, a Matchroom show in late October, early November. So at least he gets two fights this year. You know, it's been a night because we've got a good pace going with him. But, you know, we believe we have something special there. And, you know, we're ready to take the right challenge at the right time. You know, it is quite hard to find opponents for him. Not going to lie. People don't really queue up to fight him. But, Tom Little, is he going to fight Babich?
No. He said he wouldn't mind fighting Babich. He said he's there for that fight. But Babich was saying Babich was saying he wanted Hrgovic.
Yeah. I mean, let him beat Tom Little. I think Tom Little will beat Babich. That's my prediction.
No chance.
Is Babich with you?
He's with doing them. It's all he's not beating Babich. Babich is a wrecking machine. I actually like Tom. I was going to say something funny, but you know what? Tom always gives me a love, so I'm going to leave the little jokes. But it's going to be too strong. He's overwhelming. Do you know the funny thing? Like, you see, Tom Little is actually a very gifted athlete. When you see him in sparring, $1 million. I've even said it last week. If you watch him in sparring, it is mad how good he is in sparring, but it just never translates to fight night.
Will they do the fight at cruiserweight, or will it be at heavyweight?
No. Babich is just gonna, you know, fight at heavyweight. He wants all the little fake smoke, so he's obviously. It's kind of mad because Hrgovic is quite big, but obviously they're countrymen. They know each other. They've shared thousands of rounds together, so you know it's one of them. I mean, listen. Let's see what it is. I think, obviously, Babich is just starting out. Hrgovic is kind of a little bit in front of him. Babich needs to just go his own lane. There's fights there for him to make. They've got him a fight October the 4th anyway. He needs to go and get past whoever that kid is. I don't know who that kid is.
It's not Tom Little.
No. It's, I can't remember the guy. Where's he from? Newcastle, Scott? I don't know. I think I saw something. I can't remember. Is it Kennedy or something? Is it Kennedy? The guy's name is. I don't know.
It's news to me. Let's find out.
He's fighting that kid, whoever that is, in a few weeks. But he just stays ready. Look, they've got him active. Doing them guys have got him active, so he's out. He's ticking over. He's ticking the boxes at the minute. He's going in there doing what he says. So he is what he says on the tin. He's blowing out these guys. I know he wants harder challenges, but, you know, I feel like, you know, if they step him up the right way, he'll get the right challenge, get a few rounds under his belt. We might see something different out of Babish. But at the minute, he's doing Tasmanian Devil. Tasmanian Devil. Get him out of there quick. He's just doing world win and just out overwhelming them and smoking them.
He's fighting Niall Kennedy next.
Yeah, see, I knew it was
that's
something
the breaking to news. Nis, just if that fight does happen, if Babic Hrgovic was to happen, how does it go?
Number one, I don't think it's going to happen.
But let's just say, let's just pretend it for a minute.
Respect, I just see it as a very easy fight for Filip at the moment. I don't know what Babic will progress into. Like Dean said, I think he needs to fight a Tom Little, a Dave Allen, and you know, step it up in the right way. I don't think we've seen enough of him. I think, you know, in June, middle of next year, if he's gone the right way and he's ticked the right boxes, then let's see. But at the moment, I just don't think there's a point in fighting. You know, if Hrgovic beats him, which he will, sorry, Dean, if he loses in the instance that he twists his ankle or a pig flies in and hits him on the head,
or he gets a big meat cleaver on the chops, bosh, whack, crash, wallop.
He has to reach his chin first.
you said naughty man, naughty man.
I just think, you know, it's good. I understand what you're doing. It's good to sort of call out people, and I don't think he's serious about the fight yet. I think it's something that, if built correctly and he wins the right fights and everyone checks the right boxes, it could be a huge fight for Croatia middle of next year.
What level is Filip at now then? What would be a good fight for Filip rather than these fights to keep him busy and ticking over? If you can get him in with anyone now, what level's he at?
Was he 13? Let me just cut in. What is he, about 10, 11, 12, 13?
10 fights. 10 fights.
And 8 of those are knockouts, aren't they?
Yeah, listen, it's very hard at the moment, as maybe, you know, Dean can say as well. It's very hard to find opponents who, let's say, attack Ham. That'd be a great fight. I would love to do a Chisel. But why would they do it when they can fight, let's say, Usyk for a load of money, you know?
Yeah.
The heavyweight division's gone a bit bonkers since the Klitschko's lost and, you know, left, you know, it's become very interesting. You know, you got Tyson, you got Anthony, you got Dillian, you got Povetkin, you got all these guys making it very exciting at the top. And these guys who are on the fringe, let's say, you know, Takam, Chisora, those kind of like level, they're just waiting for their shot where they get their big payday. Why are they going to go and fight some mean diet, gold, bronze medalist, whatever, like the pedigree fighter, for not as much money as they might make fighting Usyk or Joshua or, you know, Pulev or whoever it is. But yeah, like a Takam, a Chisora, Helenius.
I was to mention that exact name there. You know, I was about to say he's actually on the up because he beat Karanaki now. So yeah. That obviously, if you're marching him on Hrgovic like how they marched on Joe Joyce a little bit, look, he fought Brian Jennings and stuff like that. Are those the kind of names you'd like to try and throw Hrgovic in with Brian Jennings?
I've got to say, but Brian Jennings is a good fighter, in my opinion. He's fiddly for anyone. That's a good name. I think I'm trying to think who Michael Hunter, he's a very good fighter. You know, he outpriced himself to fight Filip. You know, that, and I don't blame him. You know, it's not like I can say, oh, well, that's stupid. But at the moment, why would he when he's close to having, you know, a big fight? I'm trying to think that Zhang, the Chinese. Chinese guy, the big Chinese,
big fella,
Lei Zhang. You know, there's a lot of heavyweights.
What about the one from Canada? He's about the same, he's about 10-0, 12-0, big puncher.
Rivas? No.
No, not Rivas. There's a big one. It's 6'5", 6'6". It's meant to be a big punch.
Yeah.
They're about the same kind of, but obviously the pedigree might be a bit different. Amateur pedigree. I don't know much about him, but he's allegedly quite a big puncher.
Is it car something? Let me have a look. Am I all right to do that?
Yeah.
Of course, man.
The baby's out. Yeah.
That's what we should be doing, shouldn't we? We should be doing that. Cracking the tins.
I'm on day four, I think. No alcohol. That's good business.
The shake stopped now.
Just get me. Well, while you're looking that up, I was going to say there's a lot going on Sauerland at the minute. Obviously, we've had our ear to the ground with you boys. What happened? There was a fight the other week with one of your guys, lost a very, very contentious split decision over in, was it in Germany? Abbas Barau and Jack Hulkey?
Yeah.
I spoke to a few people who watched that fight since. They want the rematch. They were saying it wasn't, maybe the decision should have gone the other way. What do you think about it?
I think it's one of those fights which, you know, we lost by a round or two. We thought we won by a round or two. It wasn't so much of having such a close fight. It was just the way that one of the judges had just scored basically the first five rounds to Kolkai and then the sixth round of draw. So basically, Abbas had to win to you know, every round from then on. If you watch the fight back, I think Abbas wins every round, all five rounds. So it was just, for me, it was like he marked his sheet before the fight even started. You know, so there was no chance of even winning. That's what really got to me. Yeah, the judges was, you know, it's subjective and whatever else, but I think about 85%, I think we did a poll of people who saw the fight, thought that Abbas had won. He did the far better work. I mean, it was his 10th fight or 9th fight, I can't remember, but it was a really good fight. He's very talented, and maybe he's not ready for a world title. Maybe this is a godsend to us. Maybe people at the moment seem to be rushing their fighters very, very quickly. Listen, he went 12 rounds with an ex-world champ who gave Lomachenko one of his toughest fights. And Andrade one of his toughest fights. So this guy's world quality, and he outboxed him mostly, and in most people's eyes beat him. So losing a fight at this stage of his career, you know, you go back, you think about what you've done, maybe do the rematch. We do the rematch straight away because we've seen, I think he had more in the tank left. So if he stepped on it a bit more, I think he could have stopped Kolkai. But at the same time, you know, sometimes it's a blessing in disguise, because is he ready to fight for a world title? You know, I'm not going to be that promoter who says, you know, go, you've got to fight for the... No, I think he's three fights away from a world title. And whatever everyone says about that, I'm just being honest, you know? Would I take the Canelo fight or whoever fight if there was millions on the table? I would probably say to the kid, yeah. I mean, it might be one.
Where's the rest of
you know what I mean? What is the point in whoever who's the champion? Rosales or Charlo, you know, is he ready? I think he is, but I'm not sure he is. You know, so just wait. Just he's young and he can do a lot. You know, he can do a lot in this in boxing. So there's no point in rushing.
Go on, Dean.
What I'm trying to grasp here is, I know he was some form of a decorated amateur, just so I could get what was his amateur? Did he do the Olympics, World Games? What did he?
World Championships. He got the bronze medal at Worlds. In Germany, it's often like here, political. He didn't go to the Olympics. I can't remember exactly the story behind the Olympics. He got the World Gold Medal. Highly touted. Very good amateur career. Special talent.
I think obviously I know a little bit about him, and I did check that. So what is the necessary at 9 fights to have moved him on so quickly? Why wouldn't you get him to around 14, 15 before you give him this fight? I'm just curious in the mindset.
We got the opportunity to fight Korkai. We looked at Korkai. We know Korkai. We promoted Korkai. We know Korkai can't hit. He got a lot of tough fights. He's coming to the end of his career. We saw it as no-lose situation. Because people know his name. We're talking about Abbas Barrow, yeah? If he'd just beaten Korkai, we might not have been talking about him. But because it was a controversial decision, we're suddenly talking about the kid. We saw it as a situation. Because if he beats him, we're mandatory, yeah? If he loses, we knew that he'd lose on a very close point decision because Korkai could never stop him because he's got feathered pillow fists. So we that was a calculated risk, and yeah, it was maybe, you know, like you say, it was too early, but he's done 12 rounds before, and he was doing 12 rounds in sparring pretty easily. So we were happy with that. Adam Booth, I asked Adam, and I take Adam's opinion very seriously. I think he's got a lot to say in boxing, a lot of knowledge. I gauged his reaction. He said yes straight away to the Korkai fight. So, you know, sometimes as a promoter, you might want to really, really, really want something, and a trainer can frustrate you because he doesn't want it. The trainer's normally right, you know. The trainer is normally right because he knows his fighter. They're a good trainer. I'm not talking about some of these guys that just never want to take a challenge ever. They just want to fight. You know, easy fights for the rest of their career and get paid for it. That, you know, I think a good trainer knows when his fighter is ready and the right fight for his fighter. And I think he didn't lose anything out of that fight.
We had Lyndon Arthur on here the other week, and he was talking about Floyd Mayweather had this O throughout his whole career. And because he made such a big thing of it, it's now seen as a big thing. If you lose that O, you know, every loss is a massive deal. When really, you know, take Anthony Joshua lost his O. Does that mean nobody wants to fight him anymore? Do you know what I mean? These guys that can lose their O and their career doesn't take a knock.
Ali, all these guys have lost, haven't they? Oh, did Joshua's lost? Didn't he? Yeah, to Max Schmeling. Yeah, of course. He lost a few times. I mean, in the old days as well. You know, people used to lose. That's why I like MMA. I don't watch it regularly, but I like the fact that people lose. People lose all the time, and then they come back into another fight. There's no
chance. You know, they've got hands look with some of them, you know, and then they're still, like, you've got the Diaz, you've got Masterville. Look at Masterville, he's had a resurgent. Look at him. I love you as well.
Well, who did he fight? He fought that guy recently. Who did he fight?
Which one? Masterville.
Masvidal, yeah, the guy with the braids.
Who did you talking about? The rest of the guy, which he came out and knocked him out in the first 20 seconds.
No, that was the knee, wasn't it? No, he fought. Was it Nigerian guy, wasn't he?
This is my downfall.
Yes, I know you're talking. Did he fight?
He was kicking him in the shins.
The champ? Did he fight the champ? Did he fight for the belt?
Yeah, he jumped in last minute. A week to go, he just jumped in. Someone got injured, he jumped in.
He never won that fight, did he, though?
No, he lost on points.
Yeah, so I think he got Adesanya.
What's that?
You got Adesanya. It's the other one. I can't remember his name right now.
Kamaru Usman.
Yeah, Usman. Usman. Mate, that
thanks, man. Google.
Yeah, do you know what it is? I love MMA. I'm using my phone, so I'm smoked. My bloody battery's even dying. I don't know how this is going to work. I can't see the bloody... I'll
put myself in 1 minute. Sorry, lads.
That's that.
Yeah, that's brilliant, man. How did you do that?
Yeah, come on. Give me some love. No, my bloody battery's gone. Everything's just going...
Your camera's
Hold on. Bear with me. There we go.
I'd love to see your setup. Last week when it was swinging, like on the door.
You know what it is? I've had to put, it's a charger packet. I've had to put it on something so I don't go hold it. It's so heavy, it's swinging the bloody the thing. It's a nightmare.
So where were we? If you lose your O, it's not career over.
Yeah, no way. It's not. Look at back from the Joshua, and obviously now he's in a position where he's got to bounce back again from the Povetkin loss. So I think the O doesn't define you, like you were saying. Mayweather made it like that. But look at Adrian Broner. He's another one. He's every time he steps up to the best, he's lost. But he's still a big, big pay-per-view attraction. He's a big fighter that draws money and does his thing. And there's a few guys you got. What's the
Manny
next kid?
Manny Pacquiao. Manny Pacquiao.
Obviously, he's a top notch. I'm talking. You got Porter as well. Look at Porter.
Let me ask you guys. I know it's moving on a little bit, but with Manny Pacquiao, Lomachenko, all these other names, Canelo that's doing the rounds. Have you seen the latest, like these top 10 pound for pound conversations? I don't know where you get involved in those conversations, but BoxRec have got theirs out, The Ring have got theirs out, and there just seems to be a few talking points, shall we say.
I think that's boxing in a hole.
Can you read too much into it? Because how can you really rank? How can you really compare Vasyl Lomachenko to Tyson Fury?
No, Inouye to Tyson Fury.
Yeah, well, he's not even on BoxRec. Was it BoxRec where I knew he's not even in it? He's not. I'll get a list up now.
That makes no sense to me.
How is that? It's not happening.
Weird, isn't it?
Objective, isn't it? It's a conversation starter. There's no wrong or right. I mean, there is wrong. But you know, you can put obviously a total donkey in the top 10. But you know, it's a discussion point. We're talking about it right now. I mean, I personally would say that Inouye's got to be up there. Lomachenko's got to be up there. Fury's got to be up there at the moment, definitely. Canelo's got to be there somewhere.
Why is people? BoxRec has got Inouye at 21.
Yeah, that's
in the top 20.
Their algorithms changed. It's gone a bit weird. Like it's definitely. It's not made a lot of sense lately. I've found with BoxRec, it's just like some people are ranked higher, some people dropping. I know they changed their algorithm recently. So
I don't think there's any point in comment on, because if you look at the welterweight ranking over here, like based on some of the fights and some of the names people have beaten and who they faced, the welterweight ranking's crazy. They've got guys who ain't even fought anyone ahead of guys who have beat. Guys who had higher ranking than some. It's quite weird.
I mean, I'd listen to The Ring. I wouldn't listen to this like computer based. I think you need an opinion. You know, you can't compare. How are you going to compare a 7 foot guy to a 5 foot five guy? I don't know. It just doesn't make any sense.
The Ring's top 10 didn't have Tyson Fury in it. I don't know what answer I'm looking for there. I just found that.
That's an odd one, but
no Josh Taylor either.
That's mad, isn't it?
The Ring champ. They're both the Ring champs, aren't they?
Yeah, which is crazy because Usyk's in there, and if he's campaigning at heavyweight, Tyson Fury's got the Ring heavyweight. Yeah. But I don't know, mate. I don't know. Goes over my head.
Usyk Chisora, what's your prediction for that?
We had this last week. I'm going for questions. Thanks for having us on this. I think Usyk comes away with the points decision. I think I like Chisora, but Usyk can make guys swing and miss. I think he's so good. I don't know. Dean, obviously you know Derek better than I do. What do you reckon?
Listen. At the end of the day, if you're talking about the pedigree, Usyk's very talented. He can move, he can box, he can punch. He sets beautiful traps. He knows when to work it. He picks a target and he keeps working there for a little while. and then he changes it up. I watched him again today, funny enough. I study a lot of fighters. I've watched it about 10 times anyway, but I watched it again today, Witherspoon versus Usyk. And
What was I didn't see that. It was quite a tough fight for him, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a tough fight, and he was getting caught a lot in there. So this is what gives me medium, a little bit to ask something like, well, if I don't know much, I think, to be honest, I shouldn't say that because I don't really know much about Witherspoon. I think he had a decent amateur career anyway, is what I think when I read up somewhere. I think he'd done good. And he looks like he was tall, you could use his jab, and he knew his way around the ring a little bit. But like I said, he was catching Usyk with shots. He was lining him up. Usyk looked a bit slower than maybe we're used to seeing, because put on obviously a little bit of weight to compete at heavyweight. But what I'm looking at is, I'm in there with Chisora every week, and he is strong. I see their game plan, and I think, you know, potentially might eat some liver to try and get...
Who's training Dell now?
Is it Don Charles?
No way. He left Don Charles very long time ago. So I think obviously David's in there, helps him.
David, of course. What am I talking about?
David's in there. There's another chap in there that helps him. But Chisora. He's going to come in there and war it out. It's called War Chisora. So he's got his own fighting style and just a little bit of reassurance.
I reckon I haven't seen the odds, but I don't know if I'm allowed to say this, but it's not my fight, but I would put some money on Chisora just because I reckon you'll get probably 4-1 on it. And I think it's 70-30 in favour of Usyk.
Mm-hmm.
But does his power transcend to the heavyweight? And what we saw with Chaz Witherspoon, I don't know, apparently he doesn't. And he gets caught a lot. Like you say, people always compare Lomachenko. He gets caught a lot more than Lomachenko. Look at the Braidis fight. He gets caught a lot.
Can he take that onslaught of Derek Chisora continuing? But the thing is, I feel like he's got very good movement and he's gonna move all night. Derek Chisora's gonna have to hunt him down. I said if they're smart, they wanna try and ask for a smaller ring.
You said that last week.
18 footer. 16.
I like the good old Klitschko days. Klitschko was a Dan Dada. He used to get the big old ring, blow them out, make it big, run circles around them, tire them out, beat them down, get them out of there, jab them, bore them to hell, and get them out of there. But look, if he can get a smaller ring and make it a bit more intimate, close the distance, double jab, immediate rough him up, dog fight, go to the body, go to the head, and just try and mull him and see if that works. Because watch this. He's not used to that kind of... I don't think he's going to even have faced anyone like Chisora that just relentless, continue coming forward, taking lick in their face all night just to dish the dirt. And the dirt he's going to throw, you don't want to be in the way of.
from a promoter's aspect, it's a pretty good fight to have, isn't it? Because you look at the way Usyk sells on social media, the way he acts and stuff.
Derek!
He is mad.
I think any fight with Derek Chisora, listen, people talk about pay-per-view fighters, yeah? Generally, there aren't that many of them, right? Dillian is one, but Dillian needs a dance partner, yeah? Mm-hmm. Dillian does need an Andy Joshua. Yeah, he's a pay-per-view, definitely, but you also, you know, you need a B-side. Derek, I reckon he could just fight himself in there because it's so entertaining. Sometimes he is fighting himself in there, you know. I'm just trying to check if there's any odds out on that.
Usyk is fine. You seen him in the canoe.
Yeah. Derek.
Derek, where are you, Derek? Derek.
I saw the one where he was dancing. He was dancing in the ring the other day. Derek. It's just
one of the funniest things, man. He's a bit mad as well, to be fair. So
he's got that look. He's got the look. Yeah. Usyk's got a lock where he's just...
It's a case of, you know, kill or be killed. Just keep going in there. Pardon that, those words, touch wood. But, you know, just chase him down. You're going to take a few shots, but just try and get that one big one in and see how he takes it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Chip away, man. Chip away.
Oh, my back. Sorry, no.
Yeah. Well, listen, I know I'm keeping one eye on the clock because we always do this, Dean. We say to people, do you want to come on for 20 minutes? And then we best part of it. But just tell us. I know we've got our notes here, Nisse, but what fights have you got coming up that you are looking forward to? Like, I know we've spoken about someone, I know we've got some here, but you've got a big list.
Yeah, we've got a few coming up. We're finalising a card for, well, we've got September 26th, we've got a show in Denmark. We obviously got Filip on that. Then September 26th is obviously the World Boxing Super Series. I'm not involved in that. But it's a good fight. I look forward to it. Brady's daughter Goss. It's going to be a war. I'll be watching that in Denmark. Very excited by that. And then October... Well, no, so September 30th, golden ticket, golden contract. We've got Serge Michel, who we help out with. He's fighting there. I think he's got a good chance. He's a very good boxer.
Who's he fighting? Tyson Fury's cousin.
Not Burton. Is it Conroy? No, I'll tell you now.
Oh, it's Conroy. Okay, yeah, go on.
Am I saying it right?
We lost you for a second.
I call my daughter the wrong name sometimes. Liam Conroy. Yeah, that's what I meant. Sorry. I was saying I forget my kid's name sometimes. So, Conroy. Yeah. I remembered his name. I think that's a very good fight, very evenly matched. Then October 17th, we're looking to do something in Germany. We're cracking on with the shows now. We got obviously Zach Parker against Hertel.
When's he out?
That should be November time, November 21st. And we got female fight Thanders, Katarina Thanders against Terry Harper.
I was going to say that's WBC, isn't it?
That's what?
That's a WBC ordered fight.
That's a WBC. I thought you said it's going to be on the BBC. I was like.
Gap in the market.
Yeah, use for that. And it's women's boxing, you know, doing the right things. And then we've got Patrick Fujiki in an eliminator. We've got quite a bit on, to be honest. It's going to be a busy part. Like I said, everything's kind of frozen, been waiting, and now it's moving again. I sort of wake up in the morning, birds are singing, you know, walk up to the shop, have a coffee, relax. You think it's locked down, it's, you know, nothing's really happening, and suddenly the phone starts fucking ringing. <You're> like, oh. back to the grind.
And Dean, Dill's fight has been confirmed, the rematch is. I know we speak about it every week, but we have to, it's massive, and it's now confirmed, it's happening.
It's showdown, redemption.
Ask a silly question, how confident are you?
Do you know what? I've always been confident. Even in defeat, it was one of them ones where I've always respected Povetkin because he's a hell of an athlete. He's got a hell of a resume of them destructive knockouts. If you see his accumulation, he's always was dangerous. And I did the IFL interview today. They came to the gym today, so I did that earlier. And the day before the fight, I said the same thing. The only fact I have is that I fear, you know, that the uppercut is a dangerous shot. And I know that's one of his trademarks. Everyone's talking about the left hook. He's still going to be dangerous in there. But then what it is now is sometimes it was the unknowing, you know, going in there, maybe unknowing what Povetkin was going to turn up. Dill went in there, he faced him. And then he's probably got a bit complacent in the foot, said, well, you know, cruise control, winning, maybe switched off to a degree. Tried to throw a shot, left himself open and got caught with a wonderful laid plan. He was trying that uppercut all night. He did set the trap from early, going to the body and doing his thing. And this is what I saw. And I don't know if everyone saw the same thing. Some, you know, saw it different. But at the same time, I felt like Dill was making a few errors at the same time in there. There was a few things. He boxed really well, but there was a few things that he was doing in there. He was jabbing and kind of leaning in. He was over his front foot of the jab and not staying on balance. You know, he should have been trying to keep the distance a little bit more, I felt. You know, do your work and get off, because basically he needs to be in short range, mid-range to do what he needs to do for Vetkin. That's why going to the body was working, because now he's set that wheel in motion for Dillian to think body, 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 he's going to come with the left. And he threw the uppercut here and there, and it just missed. So what it is now, Dill's more concerned because his body's getting levered and he knows the hook's going to come. So he's blocking them, missing. And then he weren't really, he kept leaning here. So it's only a matter of time that he was, you know, he was going to kind of try and get it. He'd done it a few times and missed. So moving forward, I have the same confidence. You know, Dill's mentally tough, strong. And I feel like he's going to go in there and make the right adjustments. Obviously, the team, I don't know what they've saw. I spoke to a few people. I didn't go in depth with them. We all see different things. Everyone looks at and analyzes things different. But what I will say, I do a lot of homework. So for me, I just break it down and look at things different. How, you know, I look what a person does. And then if we're talking about the left foot, like I said, I felt like he was always going to change from that. And that was just for the uppercut. And we look at different things. I feel like, you know, Povetkin is Povetkin. He's not going to go and change a winning formula. He's going to come with the same thing, strong, come forward, and just do what he does. You know what I mean? It's a little wrecking ball. But I feel Dill needs to be maybe... I felt like the jab was good. I felt like in the Rivas fight, the jab was a bit more sharper, a bit more piston-like, you know, a bit more snap. At the same time, you know, maybe he didn't want to jab too much because obviously he knows his jab. Mama's going to throw the overhand or whatever it was. But I felt like he could have maybe fainted a little bit more and then stepped on the jab, a bit more solid, try and push him back as opposed to jabbing, just touching him and making him come forward. You know what I mean? I don't know. Listen, it's all good talking from the comforts of this lovely chair. I mean, you know what I mean? When you're in there and you're thinking, you're trying to wonder what's going on, you're trying to set your own traps and formulate your own game plan, and then you're thinking, right, the chess move, if I do this, he does this, and he does that, and then if I do that, what negates this? You know, like, it's only split seconds to make these decisions. The decision when Dill stepped in with that right hand to punch, he touched, came under, that was a split second decision, and Dill was, momentum was taking him forward with that, and then he got the uppercut. So that's how the double impact compounded, that's how that knockout was so devastating. So slight things he needs to, you know, look at and do. But I'm not going to lie, I still feel confident. It's a hard fight. It's always going to be a hard fight. But I'm confident in the notion that when you look at the pedigree of Dillian as an amateur and you look at the pedigree of Povetkin as an Olympian and a former world champion, Dillian's in and around the conversation for the minimal amateur fights he's had. And I think, you know, listen, one thing, Dill is a very smart kid, and it, you know, when he goes in there, I'm sure he's going to give it his all and try and cover the gaps which was there and make some adaption. But it's a hard fight. It's a hard fight.
It's a big one. Which way do you think it's going, Nisse? Do you think Dillian or Alexander?
I mean, I've known Povetkin since he came out. My brother signed him fresh out of the Olympics. I mean, I said this to Dean. I said, I've seen it when fighters, and I think Dillian, I don't want to jinx anything. You know, I wish the best for him. I really like him. And I think he's one of the guys that we need around at the moment. And I think, you know, he fights anyone. He just wants to fight. And I like that. I think Dillian boxed beautifully. I think he was doing everything right. And it was a punch from the gods. Yeah, that you know, that won't happen again. That's a one in a million shot. Yeah, but my only reservation, I'll speak honestly here, I'm not, you know, is to get knocked out like that. I feel like you should exercise the demons in an easy fight before going back into the direct rematch. I know sometimes you don't have the choice. I know it's not an ideal world, but sometimes, no matter how tough you are up here, and I know he is, and this is not a criticism. This is me just analysing it out of a little bit of experience in boxing and seeing it happen with certain fighters that I've worked very closely with one being George Groves. I think when you get knocked out in that fashion, it's very hard to just jump back into a tough fight again. I think sometimes you need to go through and I saying that, I think Dillian's a tough bastard and he'd be fine. But that's my only reservation.
Yeah, no, I can see this. Because
I think he was boxing the best I've ever seen in box.
A lot of people say that.
And I think there's a lot of credit here. Like what you say is about the amateur. I didn't think about this because he had no real amateur. Correct me if I'm wrong. But he was a kickboxer, right?
So Whyte had seven amateur fights, yeah.
He's still learning.
On the job.
Yeah. Exactly. And he's fighting a former world champion who won Olympic gold, who has had all the amateur, you know, he's had all the experience in the world. So I think all these haters and, you know, that's one thing that really annoys me about boxing. The guy went in there, wore a bar in his sleeve, he got knocked out. So what, that's boxing. You don't have substitutes. It's not fucking football. Yeah. My only reservation, like I said, is just getting in there within 3 months. And I rate it. I think it's brilliant. It makes it actually make it more exciting. And I can't wait for the fight. But that's my only reservation. He was boxing great up until that point. Punch from the gods. 1 in a million shot. Perhaps he could have finished it in the fourth.
That's hindsight, eh? Wonderful thing.
Benefit the beauty of hindsight.
Absolutely.
I do believe that he's a different animal since whoever fought Joshua. That he's a different guy in there.
Yeah, and
I'll be honest, I didn't think much of Dillian when he fought Joshua. I saw him against Pavek in those first few rounds, and I thought, now that he's world class now, and he got caught for sure. But that just makes sure. That's the beauty of boxing, yeah.
That's the beauty of heavyweight boxing, is mainly, but in boxing,
it's not over till it's over, is it? Listen, guys, I am going to say we've got to start winding. That I've kept you for way too long. Look at that. He's hovering over the red button.
Oh, you better not, son. You better not.
Yeah. He's coming.
But no,
to be honest, let's do this again. Yeah,
100%.
We have four people on here,
actually, of course, mate. Yeah,
who you fancy? Who you trying to bring on? Your dog? Oh,
yeah, mate, my dog.
We got a mad dog here.
Yeah, Matt, you got a dog.
We got some dogs, but I'm not a dog, I'm not a major dog fan anyway. But I mean.
Literally.
What about your brother? Bring him on one of these days as well, man. We'll do it.
Hey, man, I'll bring him on. Yeah. Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Get it in the diary. Cheers, boys. I appreciate your time tonight.